morning. God bless you and happy Sunday. Happy Independence Day. My prayer is that as we celebrate the freedom that God gave to this country, we will continue to live and celebrate God's freedom for humanity. In Jesus' name, let us pray together. Father, we want to say thank you so much. We appreciate you for this very beautiful day, the beautiful weather. We thank you so much for your love for us. We thank you, God, for the founding fathers of this country. Thank you, God, for their love for you. And Lord, we thank you for the freedom that they fought for. And Lord, more importantly, we want to thank you for the freedom that you have won for us in Christ Jesus. We want to say we are grateful to you. And Lord, as we come to worship you today, we pray that may we do it with the freedom that you have given us. May we, O God, know that truly in your presence there is liberty. In your presence there is freedom of worship. Thank you, Lord Almighty. We say, come, Holy Spirit, and take absolute control of this service, whether we are here in person or online. Father, we pray that we will know that your presence is with us. In Jesus' precious name, I pray. Amen. We say the prayer of invocation together. Almighty God, to you all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the Torahs of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand as we worship together.
Skies for amber waves of green, for purple mountain majesties above the breath are stored. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching. Fires up the hundreds earthquake camp. He had builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I agreed the righteous sentence by torment lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Marching on, in spite of all that the enemy is doing, and no one can stop God. God bless you. If you were born in the month of July, or you gave birth in the month of July, we'd like you to remain standing. We want to celebrate you and celebrate the children that God helped you to bring forth. Okay, so church, let us sing.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Contagious children. Happy birthday to you.
God bless you. Right, let me pray for them. Father, thank you so much for these, your children. Thank you, Father, for the very day they were conceived, the very day they were brought forth into this world. Thank you for your grace upon them. Lord, we commit them into your hands, whether they are here or they are far away somewhere. Lord, we pray that your grace will continually rest upon them. You brought them forth into this world. We pray, Father, that they will live to fulfill glorious destiny in the precious name of Jesus Christ. We ask, Lord, that you will order their steps in life and continually glorify your name in their lives. We say, God, glory be to your name. In Jesus' precious name, we have prayed. And the church say, amen. Good morning once again, and welcome to Main Street United Methodist Church. And we want to thank God for the opportunity that we have to worship Him, the living and wise God. the only God that is alive. And if you are worshiping with us for the first time and you are here in person, it is our joy to know that you are here, and we would like you to please communicate with us through the notification card that you can find right in front of you. We'd like to know you more. And if you have a minute after the service, I would like to just have a word of prayer with you before you leave. And if you are worshiping for the first time online, we also like to know you more. You can communicate with us through our email address or the phone number, which you will find wherever you are worshiping, whether on our website or our Facebook page. God bless you as you do so in the mighty name of Jesus. And I congratulate every one of us for seeing another Independence Day of this great nation that God has so much endowed with grace. Just like the song that we sang today, this country is blessed on every side. You talk of mineral resources and, in fact, human resources. God has blessed this nation with it. And I pray that the freedom that we celebrate will continue to be a true freedom in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Please, I call your attention to the news insert in the bulletin. Kindly go through it. And I just want to emphasize that my vacation begins tomorrow. Please remember me and my family in your prayers for these 2 weeks. After the service, we have the adult Sunday school, and the youth also will be meeting for their Sunday school. This is Melanie. As she comes up, we did forget twice to give fathers their candies on Father's Day. And I don't know how we forgot that, the Father's Day, and then last Sunday, we forgot to give you your candies. So if you are here in person or you are online worshiping, your candy is here. If you are here in person, please, after the service, just pick one from the table. And anytime during the week, you can please come here and also pick yours. We still have the prayer opportunity in the prayer room. And I thank God for testimonies that we are receiving. Walk up there. There are prayer warriors there during this announcement, during the focus on the children, and during the administration of the Holy Communion today. God bless you.
Okay. Back, I don't know how many years ago, all I know is Steve Ailes was pastor. We ordered church shirts, and those shirts have served us well. A lot of people still have them. I still have two, but it's time to update. So we have a table in the back for you to order your shirts. Missions is going to subsidize it, so the shirts are $5 or $6, depending on the style. And then those are T-shirts, and there's also polo shirts, if you would want those, and those are $12 each. So we encourage everyone to get a shirt so you can wear it to different events. I'm sure we'll have, like, T-shirt Sundays where we'll wear those. But there's a table back there signed up, so get those signed up. They're going to be ordered on the July 19th, so we're not going to collect any money until they come in. I figure that's just going to be easier. When you pick it up, you can pay. So they should be in by the end of July if we get the order in by the 19th. There's two different colors. You can get blue or black. On the picture, the blue one, it kind of looks like the background fades in, but it does not. It's just the way it printed. So it's kind of a sapphire blue with a navy blue background, and it does stand out, but just on that picture, it does not. So get your shirts ordered. That's it.
If you have any question on that, please talk to Melanie after the service. Focus on the children.
Do you still remember what this little flag means? That's right, July 4th. Do you have one of these at home? Anybody got a flag up at home? Do you? I saw a lot of flags when I came into church this morning along the streets. Well, I want to talk about the 4th of July and what it means. And the 4th of July means independence for our country. Okay? That means we have independence to choose so many things in our life. And it's when you're born in the United States, you don't think about that. But if you lived in another country that did not have that freedom that we have, I'm sure you would know. Like, let me tell you, you've got choices. Where you want to, what you want to wear. Well, probably mom or dad kind of limits that. Or where you go to school. There's another one that you kind of get a little limited on that. And if you go to school, some countries don't even allow their kids to go to school. And they don't allow them to go to church. And that's the big thing for our independence, okay? It allows us to go to church. We get up, we get dressed, we come here, we worship, we see our friends, we go to Sunday school. And a lot of places do not have that. They don't have that freedom. And they could even be injured or killed if they tried to practice their religion. So we're very lucky that we have that. And one of the things that matters is Christ and our trust in him and keeping our burdens, giving our burdens to Christ. Have you ever carried something that was too heavy that you couldn't carry? Or your backpack was so heavy you about fell over because it was too heavy? And if someone comes up and says, here, let me help you. You know, let me carry some of that for you. Oh, it feels so good. Thank you. Well, that's the way Christ is with us. He comes up and takes care of our burden. If we got worries or problems, we give them to him, and then it lessens our burden. So keep in mind that lessening our burdens and giving them to Christ is celebrating our freedom and our independence. So I hope today, sometime, you will think about your freedom as you go. You may go someplace for the fireworks, or you may go someplace for a picnic or a get-together. But remember how important this flag is to our country, okay? And remind us of the freedom that we have, okay? Let's say a prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the freedom to worship you and live in a country where we have freedoms not only to worship you, but to share your love with others. In his name we pray. Amen. Okay, thank you. Have a good 4th of July, okay?
The Old Testament is taken from Jeremiah chapter 2, verses 11 through 13, verses 21 through 22, and chapter 3, verses 14 through 19. Has a nation ever changed its gods? Yet they are not gods at all. But my people have exchanged their glorious God for worthless idols. Be appalled at this, you heavens, and shudder with great horror, declares the Lord. My people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the spring of living water, and have dug their own cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water. I had planted you like a choice of vine of sound and reliable stock. How then did you turn against me into a corrupt wild vine? Although you wash yourself with soap and use an abundance of cleansing powder, the stain of your guilt is still before me, declares the sovereign God, Lord. Return, faithless people, declares the Lord, for I am your husband. I will choose you, one from a town and two from a clan, and bring you to Zion. Then I will give you the shepherds after my own heart, who will lead you with knowledge and understanding. In those days, when your numbers have increased greatly in the land, declares the Lord, people will no longer say, the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord It will never enter their minds or be remembered. It will not be missed, nor will another one be made. At that time, they will call Jerusalem the throne of the Lord, and all nations will gather in Jerusalem to honor the name of the Lord. No longer will they follow the stubbornness of their evil hearts. In those days, the people of Judah will join the people of Israel, and together they will come from a northern land to the land I gave your ancestors as an inheritance. I myself said, how gladly would I treat you like my children and give you a pleasant land, the most beautiful inheritance of any nation. I thought you would call me father and not turn away from following me. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The gospel is taken from Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 16. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. We now reaffirm what we believe about our God in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father. And we come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated as we pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I will be doing the pastoral prayer and other intercessory prayer after the sermon. I invite you to find the sermon outline in the bulletin. Let us pray. Father, we want to say thank you so much for your grace, your love, your compassion that failed not. Lord, we pray that as we come to hear you today, you will speak to us in the very language that we understand. I pray, Father, that as we celebrate the freedom that you have given to this country, may we as a church and the church all over this nation know truly that we have a stake in the continuity of the freedom that you have given to this nation. I pray this prayer, Father, in Jesus' precious name. And the church say, amen. Today, I'm bringing the word of God to us, titled Contagious Christian Character, Hope for Another Revival in America. In today's post-Christian and post-Western society, I see that both Westerners and non-Westerners express their concern about the level of godlessness in the Western countries. Here in America, it is not only the reputation of politicians that has nosedived. Both the integrity of religious leaders and the saltiness of the church have actually fast nosediving. The church is going more the way of the world more than ever before. Instead of the other way around, where the society will see the church and follow the church, going the way of the church, asking the church, what shall we do? In 1998, one of the leading voices in evangelism and church growth in North America, Darrell, wrote this statement in his book. Christianity in North America has moved, or been moved, away from its position of dominance as it has experienced the loss not only of members, but of power and influence within society. What Darrell is saying here is that there is a shift, there is a new paradigm in the way we do Christianity, not really toward God, but that Christianity in North America has actually moved or has been moved by some forces, whether internal forces or external forces. Of course, we see that the church, our Christianity in North America has been moved by external forces today, and we can see it. We can see what is going on. We can see the discrimination against the church, against Christianity. Today in this country, it is almost forbidden for someone to, you know, to preach or try to raise proselytes, to bring people from other religion. It is almost forbidden for Christian, for the church to publicly, speak or evangelize to people. Someone can get you reported and you can become arrested. It is not because they see it as something wrong, but because of victimization. Because the enemy is actually against the church and is using human beings to fuel it, to do it. But on the other way, we can see in the same country, in the same continent, that other religions publicly, announce and proclaim their religion, their belief, and they can actually try to speak to you, to convert you. We see it also elsewhere in other countries where Islamic nations do not allow Christians to erect or build churches in their country, and they do not allow anyone to convert people to Christianity, but it is allowed for people to convert from Christianity to their religion. And it is also allowed that they can also go to any country and, you know, establish themselves, build structures, and do all that they like. We see that external, force against the church. But we also see internal force against the church, that the church is warring against itself. The church is fighting against itself. And the more it fights against itself, the more it becomes worldly instead of becoming churchy, instead of becoming what God actually wanted to be. In fact, I often hear pastors say, I don't want to be political, so I don't preach anything about politics or government. Now, I agree with them. If pastors make such statements simply because they do not want to be partisan, that is understandable. But if they make such statements just because they don't feel that they need to do it, if they make such statement because they feel that, well, let them continue to do whatever they are doing. I don't want to get into trouble. I don't want to get arrested by somebody. Then I see it as a leeway, a soft way to deny the truth that we as a church and as a matter of fact as pastors are sent to proclaim. I believe that all Christians, pastors and laity alike, are called to speak the mind of God, correct the hues in the society, and lead people to God. Therefore, for church leaders and Christians to take an apolitical stance is tantamount to disobedience. It means that we have decided to leave the ills, the evils that we see in the society continue. We don't want to do anything with it. But one thing I want you to know is that we are not the first people, as a matter of fact, pastors and priests, bishops, are not the first set of people to keep quiet when they see the truth and they don't speak the truth. In Jeremiah, which is my text for today, the portion that was read to us earlier on today, in Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 8, God said, the priest did not say, where is the Lord? The priest did not ask that question. Those who handled the law did not know me. The shepherds, that is the pastors, transgressed against me. The prophets prophesied by Baal and went after things that do not profit. Also in Isaiah chapter 42, verses 18 to 20, we see what God says. God said, hear you deaf and look you blind, that you may see. Who is blind but my servant, or deaf as my messenger whom I send? Who is blind as my dedicated one, consecrated one, or blind as the servant of the Lord? He sees many things, but does not observe them. His ears are open, but he does not hear. When you read Isaiah chapter 56, verses 10 to 12, you see the same thing. God keeps proclaiming it, that pastors, his servants, his priests, his bishops, his presbyters, his deacons and deaconesses are becoming blind and deaf to the truth. They are becoming blind and deaf to the hues in the society. They will not speak up. They will not ask, why are things going this way? Why are things not going the way that God wants? They will not go back to God. And so, God holds responsible the pastor, the leaders of the church. And I say to you today, God also holds you and I responsible. Whether you wear this collar or these robes that I wear or not, whether you stand here to consecrate the sacrament or not, as long as you belong to Christ, as long as you say you are a child of the living God, you are responsible. God has called out the church not to warm up the seats in the building called the church. He has called us out of the world, set us apart for his work, for the mission that he wants us to do here on earth, so that when we see evil, we talk about it in love. When we see sin, things that are going wrong, we try to correct it in a very amicable way. That is why we are here on earth. We see all kinds of things going on today. And when we open our TV or we tune it on, what do we see? Or we tune on our radios. We hear all kinds of news that discourage us. And I believe that it is common for us to ask questions. It is common for us to ask questions, where is this country going? What is happening in our country? Why all this hatred and division? How did we get here? We ask all these questions. And I know sometimes you feel so discouraged, you don't even know which, you know, news to listen to. You don't know which channel to actually tune to. Because you don't know who is actually saying the truth. But you know what? When we sit in our houses, when we ask these questions, and we also ask questions about hope, and we ask ourselves, is there any hope for America? Is there any hope to put an end to all kinds of ills that we see in the society? Is there any hope for the nation that has decided to neglect sexuality the way God designed it? And today, we can have some people who call themselves female in the spa of, you know, women, and suddenly somebody discovers that, wow, so this guy is actually a male, he's actually a man. So what is this? What is going on? How can you be here with women? When we see all this, when we see hatred, when we see killing, and we ask ourselves, is there any hope for this country? I've come to tell you today, there is hope for America. There is hope for America. And we have something to do about the realization of that hope, if it's going to come to reality. But I see that there is hope for this nation, because this is a nation that God has so much blessed. This is a nation that God has so much endowed with grace on every side. Then if there is hope for this nation, what are the hows? How can we go about it? We can only go about it when we realize two things, or we do two things. And there are other things that we can do. Because our Christianity, our lifestyle, is meant to be contagious. Anywhere we are meant to change lives. People who have no hope are supposed to begin to have hope. People who are in darkness are supposed to begin to come into light. People who are discouraged are supposed to begin to see reasons for life, reason to stay here and live and fulfill glorious destiny. Contribute their quota to the development of this nation. The first thing, therefore, is for us to return to the Lord. It is for us as a nation to return to God. And when I talk about returning to God as a nation, I'm also talking to the church. that the church also needs to return to God. In the book of Jeremiah, the prophet summoned the faithless and adulterous Israel to return to God. In Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 12, it says, "Return, faithless Israel, declares the Lord, I will frown on you no longer." What a merciful God. "I will frown on you no longer." We see the same statement in Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 14. God says, "Return, faithless people, declares the Lord, for I am your husband." I am your husband. The song that we sang today at the opening of this service says it all. It says it all. When you look at this nation, you see a nation that God has tremendously blessed. And they discovered it. The people discovered it very quickly. Of course, this nation has gone through all kinds of, you know, challenges. And it's still going through challenges today. But the truth is this, God has put his name here in this country. I have not seen a nation in the world whose people are so dedicated as Americans, so patriotic as Americans. But you know what? If that freedom, that liberty that our forefathers fought for must continue, the church has something to do. We have to return to God. This nation cannot turn its back to God. That was the first question that God asked us in the reading from the Old Testament lesson today. Will a nation forsake its God? Will America forsake its God? The God that helped her, the God that is still helping her up to now. And so God is saying to us that we must return to him. Listen to this. The need of the hour for America is a return to God. Returning to God, however, cannot be a superficial and emergency turning to God for help. Like we are in trouble, we quickly turn to him once we have what we need, and then we go away from him. Which is what is happening today. This country had once been in poverty. This country has once been, you know, affected by illness, by sickness. Things were not going well sometimes. This country had at the time war against itself, burned its own houses, killed its own people. But you know what? The truth is, this same country turned to God, called upon the name of God. In this country, revival broke out the first time, the second time, revival broke out. God helped this nation. But when God has given everything to this nation, it's as if we are now comfortable and we feel that we have everything, so we don't really need God any longer. And that is where we get it wrong. And if there is going to be a return to God, it must begin with you, it must begin with me. We need God at this time. It must be a resolute turning back to God in repentance. Because our God is merciful, our God is ready to forgive if we return to him. In Joel chapter 2, verse 13, the Lord says, "Now return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in loving kindness, and relenting of evil." I see the act of returning to God as a two-way step, a two-way dimension. It is usually the case in the Bible that when we return to God, he will also turn to us. In Zechariah chapter 1, verse 3, we have that confirmed. The Bible says that Thus says the Lord of hosts, return to me, declares the Lord of hosts, that I may return to you. Return to me, that I may return to you. Do we want to see God in our education? Do we want to see God in politics? Do we want to see God in commerce? Do we want to see God in our media? Do we want to see God in every sphere of this nation? The church must begin to return. And it must begin with individuals. It must begin with families. Every one of us must recognize the lordship of God in our homes. That is how revival will begin to spring up. The second thing that we need to understand about being contagious Christians is that we need to rediscover our contagious Christian character. We need to rediscover it because that is who we are. We need to rediscover it. Sometimes we forget who we are and we think that we are just here like any other person. But you know what? I want to tell you today, your baptism, your confession of faith, your confirmation, your coming to the Lord's table every month sets you apart. It makes you and I to be special people. It is not a joke that you are following Jesus. You are following him because God has made you special. Because he has set you and I apart for his glory. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus declares to us who we are. He says, you are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Primarily, Jesus was talking about his disciples here. And he was talking about Jerusalem here because Jerusalem is the city set on a hill.
And that city was supposed to be a beacon of hope to the world, but failed to do so. Israel was the people through whom God wanted to shine his light into the dark places of the world. When Israel disobeys God's agenda, God turns to the Gentiles. He turns to me, he turns to you.
You and I can still rediscover who we are. In our little ways, we can bring light to our neighborhood. We can bring light to people that we see around us. People are heartbroken today. People are discouraged. Many people are committing suicide. We hear the news. We see it. We read it. But, you know, you can be a savior to somebody. You can be the one to let somebody know that Jesus can help you. It is not the end of the road for you. You can save life. You can do it. I can do it. But we must first return to God. And we must realize who we are. Our identity is given to us by God through faith. As we celebrate the independence of this nation, the freedom that God has given to us, I want you to bear in mind that we have all reasons to thank God for. As you hear this message today, all it is all about is hope, that there is hope for this nation. And I see it, I didn't just come here to tell you, beautiful things. I know there is hope for this nation. This nation is not the worst in the world. It's not close to it. There are troubles everywhere. There are many nations that are, moving away from God. But you know why this nation is very important in God's agenda? Because God has set this nation on the hill. And when this nation goes this way and it is wrong, the nations of the world will want to follow it. That is why America is very special. And you are the one to walk for the return of holiness, of godliness in this nation. As you go out there today, rejoice and bless God for the freedom. Bless Him. I'm going to enjoy the fireworks too. And even though we are traveling today, we're going to enjoy it perhaps more than every other person. Maybe we're going to see it in about 3 different states as we travel. But I want you to know that anywhere you are, at the back of your house, in front of your house, on the porch, or you look through the window because you don't want to go out there because of your dog who is afraid of fireworks sound, whatever way you want to do it, give thanks to God as you see the beauty of the fireworks. Give thanks to God. And as you see it, tell yourself there is hope for this nation. I see it coming when we return and we become who we are to this society. God bless you, and God bless America. Let us pray. Father, thank you so much because you are good. Thank you for your love. Thank you so much, oh God, for there is hope for this nation. You have said, return to me and I will return to you. And Lord, today I pray this prayer. Lord God, by your providence, our founders won their liberties of old. Grant that we and all the people of this land may have grace to exercise these liberties in righteousness and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Almighty God, who has given us this good land for our heritage, we humbly beseech you that we may always prove ourselves a people mindful of your favor and glad to do your will. Bless our land with honorable industry, sound learning, and pure conduct. Save us from violence, discord, and confusion, from pride and arrogance, and from every evil way. Defend our liberties and fashion into one united people the multitudes brought hither out of many kindreds and tongues. Endue with the spirit of wisdom those to whom in your name we entrust the authority of government, that there may be justice and peace at home, and that through obedience to your law, we may show forth your praise among the nations of the earth. In the time of prosperity, fill our hearts with thankfulness. And in the day of trouble, suffer not our trust in you to fail. All of which we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord. O God, our Heavenly Father, you manifested your love by sending your only begotten Son into the world, that all might live through him. Pour out your spirit on your church, that we may fulfill Christ's command to preach the gospel to all people, that we may understand how contagious you have made us. Send forth laborers into your harvest. Defend them in all dangers and temptations. And hasten the time when the fullness of the Gentiles shall be gathered in, and the faithful people you have called shall be saved. Help us, Lord, to understand that we can spread the good news. We pray all these prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And I lift up today, Father, as many who are in pain right now, as many who cannot celebrate the liberty the way they wanted to celebrate it because of sickness, because of restrictions. Lord, I pray for those who are bereaved even at this time, especially we pray for those who are around us here in this city, and also, Lord, those who are bereaved in Florida. We ask, Lord, that you will please, O God, bring unto them comfort that they need. Bring unto them the hope that they need, O God, even on this beautiful day of independence. All this we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the church say, Amen. God bless you. We stand to sing the communion hymn, I Come With Joy.
I come with joy to meet my Lord, forgiven, loved, and free. And I wonder to recall his life laid down for me. His life laid down for me. As Christ breaks bread and bids us share each world division in, the love that makes us, one, and strangers now are friends, and strangers now are friends. Together met, together bound, we'll go different ways, and as his people in, we'll live and speak his
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth, or you had formed the earth. From everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, and even as we celebrate the independence, the liberty, the freedom of this nation, your people, we praise your holy name and join the unending hymns of the saints as we say, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Please be seated as we continue. Holy are you, blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. On the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take it, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave you thanks and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. And Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Together we pray the prayer of humble access. We do not presume to come to this your table. O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to partake of this sacrament, that we may walk in newness of life, may grow into his likeness, and may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Amen. And I invite the server to please come, the liturgist, the organist. Can you please come, Mrs. K? body of Christ. We will administer the communion the way we did last month. I will quickly repeat that for the sake of those who were not here at that time. So we come to the altar rail, and you can kneel down, you can stand. I will come to you and administer the bread to you. And Mrs. Susan will come along to administer the wine to you. And you can consume it. And please, you drop the cups right in the hole. So, liturgist, can you help me open the altar rail? Just open them. Feel free to also use the altar rail to pray when you have received the communion. Feel free to pray. And if you like gluten-free bread, when I get to you, call my attention to it, and I will get that for you. God bless you. Come, for all things are ready. please stand as we give thanks together. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please bring forth the offering and we sing the doxology together. Father, we say today thank you, and we bring our offering to you. And after the much you've given to us, we have brought this token. We pray, Father, Lord, that you will bless everyone who has brought this, and as many, O God Almighty, who continue to bring their offering and tithes, their pledges to you. We pray, Father, Lord, that upon those who cannot even give, but who really want to give, you will also, O God Almighty, shower your blessings upon us together. We pray, Father, that this offering will be used to the glorification of your name and the furtherance of your work here on earth. In Jesus' precious name, I pray. Amen. God bless you. Into the able hands of the Almighty God, I commit you as you go forth into this new week. May God Almighty go with you, and may you go with God. May you do everything in the name of Jesus Christ. May you also live in the faith that God's presence is without interruption, that God is with you all the time. I pray for you and your family members. Anywhere you go, you will not run into evil. I pray for you that it shall be well with you. May God Almighty surprise you. And as we celebrate the freedom of this nation, we pray that the protection of the Almighty God will rest upon all of us. And may we continually live in the freedom that Christ has given to us. And may you come back here when next we meet with testimonies of God's goodness. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. And the church say, Amen. God bless you.